Okay, welcome to a new episode of how to do the two-step PCR procedure. In the last part, we did run a gel and we have also gone through the different results you can get from a gel. Now the next step is the PCR bead cleaning. And we have two different procedures for the PCR bead cleaning. One for normal Eppendorf tubes like this, and also one that uses a PCR plate. And for the plates, we use a magnetic rack like this. And for the tubes, we use this magnetic rack right here. And I would really recommend that you are using the correct type of procedure for your samples. And this is very dependent on how many samples you have. If you have around 20 or up to 32 samples, then you can actually use the racks for tubes. But if you have more than that, then you should definitely use the plate because it's way faster and it can do multipipetting. But be aware, two different protocols. The next thing is just to explain it, why we do the bead cleaning. And the reason for this is that when we add the DNA to the magnetic beads, the DNA, at least the longer fragments of the PCR products, binds to the beads because of the magnetic force and also some other things as well. But the shorter fragments, that is normally called primer dimers, they don't bind as good. So it's a way to select between different lengths of PCR products to keep the lengths we want. And it also involves different washing steps with ethanol and also a elution step. And before you start, is some things you need to do is to read the appropriate protocol. And this protocol states very clear what you need. And some of the most important thing is that you need 85% ethanol. To mix it, you take the volume need of 96 and add the right volume of water to get the right percent. And it's important that it's water that is very, very, very clean, or PCR grade water as it's called, so you don't add any contaminants. Okay, the next thing you need is to do some calculation on how much volume of beads you need. And the normal range is between 100%, which means that you have the same volume of DNA or PCR product and the same volume of beads, down to 0.5, so 50% of the beads compared to the normal DNA. And this you do a calculation here. I have an example here in my book, where I use 0.8, and I have 55 microliters of DNA in my PCR tubes. So this amounts to 44 microliters of beads that need to be combined with the DNA. And then you need to find the total amount, which is how many samples you have, multiplied with the amount of beads you need for each sample. Okay, and I have talked quite extensively about beads. And also the water as well. We have aliquoted tubes of clean water here, and then we have the beads. Now we have changed beads to one that is called Cytiva Ceramag beads. They are a little bit cheaper, but still not extremely cheap. And they are looking like this, marked very well, and you also see that it's brown down in the bottom, and that's the actual beads. And here it's very important to get the beads into the solution. So firstly, I just shake it up and down a little bit, and to be completely sure that it's all suspended, then we just use the vortexer for maybe a second or two. After that, you will see that you have quite a lot of beads in the lid. To avoid that being a problem, just put it for maximum 1 second like this in the centrifuge, and it's all good. So now we have the beads, and these ones need to be kept cool, so then we place them back in the refrigerator. Okay, so we have the beads. The next thing is our PCR products that we have here. These ones, I would also strongly recommend to spin them down once. So you have a lot of product in top of the tubes normally when they have been defrozen and stuff like that. And if you open it, you will contaminate your fingers and you will get contamination. So always spin tubes down. So then we just use this here. Just spin it down quickly. And place them like this. Okay. So now to the more fun part. And that is actually starting to do the cleaning. And here I've taken out some Eppendorf tubes as well, and I have my samples. And what you want to do is to suck up all the PCR product and place it into a tube, and then add the appropriate amount of beads and mix them together. So I will do it now. And here I used a 100 microliter pipette, but this is something you of course need to adopt for the amount of DNA you have. So I suck it up like this, place it just normally in the tube, get rid of the pipette tip, and then I take the suspended beads and go down to 44 microliter, because that's what I'm calculating here. Open the tubes with beads. And these beads, it's a little bit important that you take the tip all the way down and suck it out quite slowly, because sometimes the bead can get stuck in the very small tip of the pipette. And then it's the same procedure, add it to the DNA, then you pipette it up and down 10 times, like this. Get rid of the tip here. And then the procedure says that it needs to sit and mix and bind for 3 to 5 minutes. I normally use 5 minutes. So now we're just going to wait for that to happen. Okay. So now we have waited for 5 minutes, and then we need to place the tube or the Eppendorf with the beads on the magnetic rack. And here it also needs to rest for between 3 to 5 minutes as well. This is to drag the beads, the magnetic beads, to the magnet over here. But while we are waiting for this, I would talk a little bit about Eppendorf tubes, maybe the most interesting thing in the world. We have used normally two different types. It's the 1.5 microliter, milliliter tubes, and the 2 milliliter tubes. I prefer the 2 milliliter because they are more rounded in the bottom. And this actually, when you are pipetting it out, makes it way easier to take away all the volume of residue, DNA, and other things without sucking out the beads. So I would recommend it, but this is kind of find your own flavor. Both of them works. And now this has been sitting here for some time, and the solution has turned from brownish to having a small dot of the bead very close to the magnet. And this is the separation. Okay. So I added now 55 of DNA and 44 microliters of beads. and it should be around 5 microliters left in the tube when you suck up all the excess. So this leads to around 80 microliters. Yeah. So then we just add this. Okay. Open here. Take a new pipette tip. And here it's important that you also use a very slow movement. Yeah, it was a little bit more left there, so I can take a little bit more out. There we go. Okay, now you get rid of most of it. Don't completely empty it, because then you can disturb the beads. So it should be around 5 microliters left. Then I take it out from the magnetic rack. The next thing to do is the washing step. And the washing is done with the 85% ethanol that you need to mix when you start. And you need to have fresh ethanol. You can maybe use it a day later, but not more than that. Always use as fresh as possible. And here I need to change pipette to a 200 pipette. Good. And the procedure says add 200 microliters of ethanol. I prefer to add 195 microliters because it's already 5 microliters of residues left. So then when you take out ethanol, you don't have any ethanol in the tube anymore. And that's kind of the goal we want. So then we add the ethanol and double check that it's the 85% one. Open this one. And then we also open this door here. And sometimes the boxes is not easy to open. And that happens. So then you just close everything and focus on opening the box instead. Because it's very easy to try to do something else and then you can get contamination. Okay, now it's open. Then we open this. And the ethanol. Take it out. Add it to the tube, expel the tip, close the lid here. Okay. So now we have added the ethanol, but we still have a very clear magnetic bead spot, and this needs to be at least partly dissolved in the solution. And here again, I like to use the vortexer just for a second or two. Now it's more or less dissolved. It doesn't need to be completely dissolved when we use the ethanol, but at least partly dissolved. And here again, I will use the centrifuge just for a very short second, just to get, if it's anything in the lid, to get rid of that. Okay. And then we look at the procedure, okay. Spin down, okay. And it says then place it in the magnetic rack for a minute. And then we just wait a minute. Okay. So now we have waited for approximately 1 minute. And what you will see here is that the solution that was originally very brown has now become clear, and we have a very clear brown spot close to the magnet itself. So this has again drawn out the beads of the solution to the rack itself. And then we need to pipette out all the ethanol. And here I adjust it up to 200 because that's the total volume in the tube. And when they are in ethanol, the beads is very stable. They are not easily drawn out. So here you can suck it, get out all of the ethanol. And this is also needed because ethanol can actually interfere with other downstream processes. So then we just open the lid here. While it's still on the rack, get out all the ethanol, close it again, and place it here. And then we need to redo the entire ethanol process again, because it's two washes. So then we get the ethanol here, open the tube with the PCR products and the beads, suck out the ethanol, and then add it. Then we close everything, and then again we have a very clear kind of brownish spot. I like to dissolve it just a little bit, spin it down just for a very small second so we don't have anything in the lid, and now we again has this brown solution, and we place it on the magnetic rack for another minute, and then we just wait and look at the solution clearing up. So while we are waiting, is kind of, I will try to explain why it's so important to do this washing, because since the shorter fragments bind way less to the magnetic beads, they are stirred out when we're adding the ethanol to the beads. Therefore, we at least minimize. It's not always that we are able to take out all the dimers. It depends on how much dimers you have, but at least we try our best. But now it looks like the solution is more or less ready, because now it's very clear and it has been a minute. Then, with the tube still on the rack, we take out all the ethanol. And here it's very important to get all of the ethanol out in the second wash step, because this can really actually interfere with the DNA amount and also quality. Wow. And then we leave the cap open and we let it dry for up to 5 minutes to just evaporate the last bits of ethanol. Okay, so now it has been evaporating for close to 5 minutes. So then we take the Eppendorf tube out, place it in the rack again, and now we are going to do the last step, which is getting all the DNA that is bound to the beads back out into a solution. And here we use a elution buffer. You can use the elution buffer that comes with the extraction kit, or you can use or a self-made elution buffer or something in between. And here is also a little bit important to read the protocol carefully, because this is the step where we actually get the DNA back out again. And I added 55 microliters of DNA in, but you also lose a little bit of DNA. So normally I use less of the elution buffer than I used with the DNA into this process. And the reason for that is that I actually make the concentration of DNA maybe a little bit higher, which is very useful for PCR2. So then I take the elution buffer, and here it's also important to spin this tube down as well, because here we have some droplets in the lid. So I just spin it down for a small second as well. Okay. Then I change pipette, to a 100 microliter pipette again. I go down to 40 microliters. Like this. Tips are already there, and then I open the tubes. And then I take out the right amount, and then I look where the beads is collected, and then I add the elution buffer very close to the beads, because this will help dragging the beads out to the solution. Then I again use the vortexer. And here it's very important that the beads are all suspended in solution. So here you don't should have any kind of small blobs of the magnetic beads. Everything should be suspended all the way. And then you need to incubate it in room temperature for 2 minutes. And while we are waiting, I can again try to explain that the elution buffer is normally very high on salt, and the salt ions will have a positive charge or a negative charge, and this will bind to the magnetic beads and take up the space of the DNA, so the DNA is kept in the solution. And now it has been 2 minutes, then we place it on the rack and let it sit for another 2 minutes while the beads is getting separated. And this is here where I really think that the 2 milliliter Eppendorf tubes are the best, because here the beads is not kind of stuck in the bottom of the tube. It's kind of dragged a little bit higher. So when you're taking out the elution buffer that contains the DNA, then you can actually take all of the elution buffer out, or maybe leave just 1 microliter left, without getting any of the beads to the preceding steps. Okay, so now it has been 2 minutes. I used 40 microliters of the elution buffer. Here you can adjust it down to 39 or 38, just to keep like 2 microliters left. I choose not to do it because I used the 2 milliliter tubes. And here, also be careful to do it quite slow and steadily. Okay, so now we got all of the elution buffer out. And now we are done with the cleaning. The things that you can do after the cleaning is go right to PCR2, or you can take a new gel to see if you have get rid of all the dimers, to look at have the concentration changed, do you have way weaker bands, and so on. And normally you will get a little bit weaker bands because you still lose a little bit of DNA or of the target DNA in the process as well. But this is also something that can be adjusted a little bit with the amount of bead concentration, because if you use a higher amount of beads, then you will bind more of the DNA. But if you have dimer issues, I really recommend to use 0.5 or 50% volume of beads compared to sample, because then the PCR product you want will outcompete the dimers. Okay, I think that was everything with the cleaning.